Well, good morning, church family. I'm glad you could join us for our Wednesday morning Bible study. If you have your Bibles, open to the book of Proverbs. We're going to continue today introducing the book of Proverbs. We began this last week, just dipping our toes in the water of Proverbs, and we're going to continue this week looking at it. If you are a member of Foothills Community Church, I want to remind you that I've sent you these sermon notes where you can follow along with us, and also have your Bibles available, and you can follow along in the Word of God. Again, open to the book of Proverbs. We're just going to give a brief introduction today, much like we did the last week, but I want to continue looking at the importance of studying the book of Proverbs. It is the wisdom of God. And honestly, in our day and age now, where there are so many uncertainties surrounding us, we greatly need to be reminded of God's wisdom and depending on God's wisdom rather than the speculations of the world around us. So again, the book of Proverbs, let's begin by bowing before the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for your word that is a rock to us, that is truth to us. I pray that it would be an encouragement this morning, that it would ground us in the peace of Jesus Christ. We thank you so much, God, for everything you've provided, for knowledge, for wisdom in the gospel. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, last week we did begin looking at the book of Proverbs, but this came after we looked at evangelism. And evangelism, just really quick recap, began by looking at the law. And we did this because we asked the question, how do we evangelize biblically? How do we do this like the prophets, like Jesus? How do we utilize Scripture to evangelize those in our lives who may not believe? And the law was exposed. We read the verses about the law of God and how the law of God leads us to the knowledge of sin, leading us to the knowledge that we need a Savior in Christ. The Scriptures say the law is our tutor, that leading us to Jesus Christ. In Galatians chapter 3, verse 24, the Apostle Paul wrote, "So then the law was our guardian until Christ came, in order that we might be justified by faith." So the law was given to us to lead us to the knowledge of sin and the knowledge that we desperately need a Savior. And in the same way, the book of Proverbs leads us to the knowledge of Christ through the wisdom of God. The book of Proverbs is a gospel book. It's about grace for sinners. Proverbs is about hope for failures. And Proverbs is about wisdom for foolish people, as we can be many times. The Bible constantly pushes us back to identify wisdom from folly, to separate wisdom from folly, to be able to discern wise things, that is the wisdom of the Lord, from the folly of the world. In Matthew chapter 7, again, these verses are going to be on your paper. In Matthew chapter 7, verse 24, Jesus says this, "Everyone then who hears these words of mine and does them will be like a wise man who built his house on the rock. And the rain fell, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat on that house, but it did not fall, because it had been grounded on the rock. And everyone who hears these words of mine and does not do them will be like a foolish man who has built his house on sinking sand." Man cannot make sense of the world around him without the wisdom of God. God is not a God that you can reason to. God is a God you cannot reason without. For something to be absolutely true in our world, it must be rooted in rock-solid facts, with no shifting sand around it. I'll give you an example. There's an atheist debater in our world today named Matt Dillahunty, and I've watched many of his debates. He debates Christians, and this is what Matt Dillahunty said once about truth. Quote, "We cannot fully know that external reality exists outside of our own minds." This is an ideology called solipsism. Solipsism basically says this, that we can't know anything outside of our own rationale, outside of our own brains. Everything that we're experiencing might just not be reality at all. If you've ever seen the movie The Matrix, that's what Matt Dillahunty kind of references it to, that this could all be some big dream. We really don't know if anything is true at all. Basically, what the unbeliever says and what this atheist says is that there is no such thing as truth. But what I would like to do is ask Mr. Dillahunty, is that statement true? You see, in saying that, he has made an absolute truth claim and contradicted himself and his own worldview. The atheist, or let's call him the unbeliever, because as we've seen in Romans chapter 1 in the past few weeks, there is no such thing as an atheist. God has shown himself, Romans chapter 1, through creation, through the things that are made, and Paul writes, so that no man has any excuse not to believe. So the unbeliever cannot account for reason. They can't explain why reason exists outside of their own minds. The unbeliever can't account for morality. We've talked about this before. They only can know what's in their own humanistic wisdom, and they can't account for morality, for right and wrong, because it's subjective. According to their worldview, it's subjective. It's whatever they feel, whatever is right in society at the time, whatever culture mandates, that is what is right and what is wrong. But it's not grounded in any truth. And ultimately, the unbeliever has no source of truth because, as Matt Dillahunty pointed out, we really don't know, is what they would say. That we really can only speculate as to if anything is true at all. So self-admittedly, the unbeliever has built his house on sinking sand that can move and shift with any push of the waves. That's what the unbelieving worldview says. Now, Isaiah chapter 5, verse 21, the prophet writes this, "What sorrow for those who are wise in their own eyes and think themselves so clever." You see, the unbelievers have no grounding for truth. They only have speculation. They only have what their own minds will allow them to accumulate as far as wisdom, reason, and knowledge. But the Christian has the solid rock of truth. The Christian can believe that reason absolutely exists because it exists in the wisdom of God. The believer in Christ knows that morality exists because, as we've talked about in the past few weeks, God has written our conscience on our heart, which tells us right and wrong. He's written his law upon the heart of man. So innately, we know what is right and what is wrong because God has revealed that to every man through conscience. That's the book of Romans. That's what the Apostle Paul wrote. So ultimately, we can know truth, that there is something true, that there is ultimate and objective truth because it is grounded and seen in the person and work of Jesus Christ. In John chapter 14, verse 6, Jesus said this, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." In Colossians chapter 3, verse 2, the Apostle Paul wrote this, "In him," that is Jesus, "in him lie hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge." And I want you to think about all of the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. Everything that you and I can know from math, science, to theology, everything, all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge, where is their origin? Well, Colossians 3:2, "In him, in Christ, lie all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge." Again, we can't know truth apart from Jesus Christ. The unbeliever cannot know truth apart from Jesus Christ. In their own worldview, it's built on sinking sand and truth doesn't exist. That's why it's so important that we as believers are rooted in the wisdom of God. And that's why I'm excited about the book of Proverbs, looking into Proverbs and really seeing this wisdom of God put on display. Without God, human thinking is reduced to absurdity and speculation. And as Isaiah, again, Isaiah chapter 11, verse 2, says, "The Spirit of the Lord will rest on him, the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and strength, the spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, and he will delight in the fear of the Lord." And listen to this. It says, "And he will not judge by what his eyes see, nor make a decision by what his ears hear." Now let's look at this verse again. If you have your Bibles, it's Isaiah 11, verses 2 and 3. If you have the paper that I emailed to you, that's on your paper, and you can see this. It says, "The spirit of counsel and strength, the spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, and he will delight in the fear of the Lord, and he will not judge by what his eyes see, nor make a decision by what his ears hear." As believers in Christ, we are not to judge the world or filter world events through what we see with our eyes. We're not to live in speculation about what is to come from what we see on the nightly news. We are to live in what we know is absolutely truth, and that is the wisdom of God. And again, this is so applicable in the current day pandemic that we're facing, when there are so many unknowns, so many things that we worry about. And what's scary about the time that we're in is many believers begin to speculate, panicking and talking about what something might mean and what might happen in the future, and trying to almost gaze into the future themselves as if to say what is coming down the pipeline. This is living in what we see. This is living in speculation. And when we live in speculation, it leads to panic and fear. It doesn't lead to resting in the Lord. It leads to chaos. We're to rest in what we know about God. I can't press that enough. As believers, it's what we know about God. Each week I have pretty much said the same thing, that what we know about God is this: that God is good, that God is righteous, that God is holy, and everything that happens in our world filters through His hands for the good of His people and the glory of His Son. And if we rest in what we know about God, we don't have to live in speculation. We don't live in panic and fear, because we rest in the promises of God, remembering the mission of God, which He has called us to, that is to preach the wisdom of God to all who would hear, that they might be saved. I want you to think about something. Speculation and conspiracy theories will not save anyone. Only the gospel of Jesus Christ will save those who are lost in their sins. We need to be those who are rock solid, standing firm on the rock of truth of Jesus Christ and proclaiming the gospel, not our own ideas from our own humanistic minds of what we think is going to be produced from this time. We rest on Christ. We preach the gospel, redemption from sins, the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, and repentance and faith in Him. That's what the world needs to hear from the church during this time. We need to preach the gospel boldly, because we are standing on the only rock, the only security that there is, that is Christ. Again, anything else that we preach, speculation or anything like that, it's standing on a mound of sinking sand. And as Christians, we should be weary of doing something like this. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 30, the Apostle Paul wrote, "And because of Him you are in Christ, who became to us wisdom from God." As I read these verses, I want you to pick up the word wisdom and how it's used in the Scripture. Again, Paul writes, "And because of Him you are in Christ Jesus, who became to us wisdom from God, righteousness and sanctification and redemption." If you remember, the scribes and the Pharisees were astounded at the wisdom of God. The scribes and the Pharisees of the first century had worldly wisdom, had their own rationale, had their own ideas about reason and how things went in the world. And honestly, they probably sounded pretty convincing to those that they spoke of, because they were highly educated men. But when they heard Jesus Christ speak and teach, they were astounded of the wisdom of the God-man. Matthew chapter 12, verse 42. Excuse me, Matthew chapter 3, verse 54. "And coming to His hometown, He taught them in the synagogue, so that they were astounded, and they said, 'Where did this man get His wisdom and these mighty works?'" I want you to think also that in the Old Testament, it was King Solomon who was declared the wisest man who ever lived. God granted Solomon great wisdom beyond anyone else who had lived upon the face of the earth. And it said the Queen of Sheba had traveled a long way just to sit at the feet of King Solomon and hear the wisdom of Solomon. But in Christ, there's a greater wisdom than even the wisest man who ever lived. Matthew chapter 12, verse 42. "The Queen of the South," that is the Queen of Sheba, "will rise up at judgment with this generation and condemn it. For she came from the ends of the earth to hear the wisdom of Solomon, and behold, something greater than Solomon is here." That is speaking of Christ. The difference between godly wisdom and earthly wisdom is life and death. It is critical. It is crucial that we are preaching and sitting under godly wisdom, again, not sedating ourselves with the wisdom of the world, because the difference And the implication is life and death. In Proverbs chapter 13, verse 14, it says this, "The teaching of the wise is a fountain of life, that one may turn away from the snares of death." So the teaching of the wise, that is the teaching of Scripture, leads to a fountain of life, and the one that follows elsewhere enters into the snares of death. Proverbs 14, 12, a very, very telling verse, says, "There is a way that seems right to man, but in the end leads to death." So there's a way that seems right to you and I. There's a way that seems right to the unbeliever. There's a way that seems right to the secular philosophist, but it leads to death because they are only living in their own wisdom, in their own little house built on sinking sand, thinking that they've done such a great job building their palace of knowledge, when again, it's sinking. It's not built on any sort of foundation. Jonathan Edwards wrote, "When the devil finds that he can keep men complacent no longer, he drives them to excesses and extravagances, and he will push them upon their own minds and into their own heads." If we are not actively gleaning wisdom from the Word of God, being filled with the Word of God, we will, even as believers, be prone to listen more to the world than anything else, driven, as Jonathan Edwards said, into our own minds and our own heads and away from the truth of Scripture. In Colossians chapter 2, verse 8, it says this, "See to it that no one takes you captive by philosophy and empty deceit according to human tradition, according to the elemental spirits of the world, and not according to Christ." Now, it's never wrong to study philosophy. It's not wrong to watch the nightly news and listen and learn of the ideologies that are in our world today. But what Paul does say is, let no one take you captive. Let not these thoughts take you captive. That is, consume your mind to where it molds how you live, how you act, what you say and what you believe. If we are living in a state of fear and preaching a state of fear to others, then we're not resting in the wisdom of God. Again, it is that image of the house of sinking sand. And I want you to look back at Colossians 2:8. Paul says, don't be taken captive. Don't let your minds be saturated and convinced to a point that this molds how you look at society. Rest in the wisdom of God. And I'll say this, Christian, if we are not resting in the Scriptures daily, you will be taken captive by worldly wisdom. It will happen very quickly. We must be tied to the Scriptures. As Martin Luther says, we need to hear the gospel often. In fact, we need to hear it daily, because Luther said we forget it daily. So it's so important that we write the words of Scripture on our hearts, on our minds, and we can quote these things to ourselves as a reminder of the wisdom of God and not the wisdom of the world. The godly wisdom is also the grace of God. It's a grace given by God. It's a gift of God. In Ephesians chapter 1, verse 7, Paul writes, "In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches of his grace, which he lavished upon us in all wisdom and insight." Godly wisdom is a grace given by God. It is a gift from God. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 23, the Apostle Paul writes, "But we preach Christ crucified, to the Jews a stumbling block, and to the Gentiles foolishness. But to those who are called, both Jews and Greek, Christ, the power of God, and the wisdom of God." If you have your papers that I've emailed to you in front of you, again, look back at 1 Corinthians chapter 1:23. Paul says, "We preach Christ crucified." This is a stumbling block to some, but it is wisdom to the believer. It is wisdom to those who are being saved. It is precious to those who are being saved. So again, I press the point. We're not called as believers to preach conspiracy. We're not called to preach our speculations. We are called to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. As Paul said in 1 Corinthians 23, we preach Christ crucified. And this is the power to save, the word of the living God. Because truth and salvation are only found in Jesus Christ. I want you to remember back in Matthew chapter 16 when Jesus explained to Peter the gospel, that he must die, that he must rise again. The Messiah must die and be crucified. And Peter began to speculate that Christ wouldn't die. Peter, in his own knowledge, what seemed right to him, remember the proverb said, what's right in man's eye actually leads to death. What seemed right to Peter was that Christ really didn't need to die. And Christ began, or rather Peter began to propound to Christ, no, listen, you don't need to die. This doesn't need to happen. Peter was thinking with his mind in a secular worldview, not according to the wisdom of God. And I want you to listen to the account in Matthew 16, 21. From that time, Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things from the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed and on the third day be raised. So Jesus explaining the gospel to his disciples. And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him, saying, far be it from you, Lord. This shall never happen to you. But he turned and he said to Peter, get behind me, Satan. You are a hindrance to me. Now listen to this. For you are not setting your mind on the things of God, but on the things of man. Jesus rebukes Peter and actually says, get away from me, Satan, because your mind is set on the things of the world, on the things of man, and not on the things of God. Peter's mind was set on interpreting the circumstances around him through worldly wisdom, not godly wisdom. You see, Peter's circumstances that he was about to experience the death of Jesus Christ, his Messiah, he was interpreting, he was filtering what was said to him by Jesus through a worldly way, a secular way of looking at things. And Jesus says, this is not only wrong, this is satanic in nature. Jesus basically telling Peter that the way that you're thinking, the way the secular ideologies that you're filtering things through, Peter, it is satanic in nature. As you know, we're going through the book of James on Sunday morning, and James writes much the same thing. James 3:13, who is wise and understanding among you? By his good conduct, let him show his works in the meekness of wisdom. But if you have bitter jealousy and selfish ambition in your heart, and do not boast and be false in the truth. This is not the wisdom that comes from above, but is earthly, unspiritual, and demonic. James pressing the same point that Jesus did, that earthly wisdom is unspiritual and demonic in nature. And the book of Proverbs, again, is the wisdom from God. This is what we filter our lives through, the Word of God, not doing it through secular means. Believers should cling to the book of Proverbs. I believe it was Billy Graham that once said that he read the book of Proverbs daily. One of the best family worship books that I have at my home really presses the point to read the book of Proverbs with your wife, with your children, with your grandchildren, because of the wisdom contained in it. And now more than ever, we need this wisdom because we live right now in a world of information. But mainly people get this information from social media, from the news reports, from television. It's a very technological age that we live in. And we get more information at times from technology than we do the Word of God. C.S. Lewis wrote once, where is the life that we have lost in living? Where is the wisdom we have lost in knowledge? And where is the knowledge we have lost in information? I believe that we need to be rescued by Jesus Christ from worldly, secular information and ideologies, and we need to be brought back to thinking through the lens of the wisdom of Christ. An old man once told me that he didn't need to read the Bible anymore because he said that he had read it so many times that he knew everything in it. And if anybody ever says something like this, it should take you back as it did me. And one of two things is true if you hear this from someone's mouth. Either they are completely ignorant or they have never read the Bible for themselves. Because the more deeply that I study the Scriptures, the more time I spend personally in the Word of God, the more that I see that I have so much more to learn. That rabbit hole gets deeper and deeper, so to speak. This wealth of information through the wisdom of God is a never-ending field of glory. In Job chapter 11, verse 7, Job says, "Who can fathom the deep things of God or discover the limits of the Almighty?" This is a rhetorical question. Who is it that can honestly say that they have reached the bottoms of the depths of God's wisdom? Who can fathom the deep things of God? In Proverbs chapter 139, verse 6, Psalm 139, verse 6, the psalmist wrote, "Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too lofty for me to attain." I love Romans chapter 13, the apostle Paul wrote, "Oh, the depths of the riches of wisdom and knowledge of God, how unsearchable are his judgments, how inscrutable are his ways." Job asks another rhetorical question in Job 15:8. "Do you listen in on God's counsel or limit wisdom to yourself?" Again, the unbeliever is forced to limit wisdom to themselves, which they will self-admittedly say they are fallible and what they know can change in the snap of a finger. Their wisdom is very limited in understanding, and they can never know ultimate truth because that truth could change with the next scientific discovery, the next philosopher and his ideas. It's never-ending sinking sand, if you will. Isaiah chapter 47, verse 10 says, "You were secure in your wickedness. You said, 'No one sees me.' Your wisdom and knowledge led you astray. You told yourself, 'I am, and there is none beside me.'" Again, this is that ideology solipsism that says that there can be no absolute truth beyond what we can think in our minds, beyond what we can come to in our own rationale. And Isaiah calls this out. Verse 47:10, the concluding portion says, "I am," this is the atheist speaking, the unbeliever speaking, "I am, and there is none besides me." More or less saying that my wisdom presides over all. And the verse again says, "You were secure in your wickedness. You said, 'No one sees me.' Your wisdom, professed wisdom, and knowledge led you astray." The atheistic mindset says there can be no wisdom outside of humanity. It says there can't be any absolute truth either because humanity is fallible, and therefore they are built on a card of sinking sand. And what's ironic to this is the unbeliever will profess there is no absolute truth, but ask that unbeliever, if you're ever in a discussion, is that statement that you just made, there is no absolute truth, is that absolutely true? Again, you see, they betray their own worldview. They talk out of both sides of their mouth. There is an absolute truth, and it is grounded in the person and work of Jesus Christ. So what happens if we seek wisdom? As we conclude this morning, again, this was just another brief introduction to the book of Proverbs. We'll begin going through verse by verse next week, but I really think it was important to lay the groundwork for us to see the great need to have godly wisdom, to preach godly wisdom, and to remind ourselves of the wisdom of God. As believers in Christ, we live in such an influential world that at times, if we're not glued to the Scriptures, we can begin to believe vain philosophies and things of empty deceit that the Apostle Paul mentioned that should not consume us. We should be on guard against this way of thinking. So what happens if we seek godly wisdom? Proverbs chapter 15, verse 24 says, "The path of life leads upward for the wise. They leave the grave behind." The path of life leads upward for the wise, for those that are rooted and grounded in the wisdom of God, and they walk away from worldly wisdom. Let us be that kind of people, even in the midst of our own pandemic, that we are resting in the knowledge of who God is and the wisdom that he's given us through the Scriptures, that we can be witnesses not only by proclaiming his word, but through the countenance that we have of peace that no one else can have. Because again, in a world of sinking sand, you can only go down, but those who believe upon Jesus Christ have the solid rock of truth, the only way, and the only life, and that is Jesus Christ. Let us be proclaimers of the gospel, that those that don't know him may be saved. At this time, let's bow our heads and go before the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you for this morning. We thank you for the words of the Lord. We thank you for the book of Proverbs and the wisdom, Lord, that we will see as we enter into this in the next few weeks. We thank you for godly wisdom and the reminder that we are to be glued to the word of God and the wisdom of God, not taken captive by any other ideologies, by conspiracy theories, by the things that the world would tell us, but only what is written in Scripture. This is our peace. This is our gospel. This is our mission. This is our proclamation to those who yet have no ears to hear yet. We thank you for Jesus Christ and everything that he's given us. It's in his precious name that we pray. Amen. God bless you.